Well, I want to tell you about some things that I've been working on that kind of come to fruition after basically 30 years of work. Actually, it'll be this August, it'll be 30 years since I started my company, Wolfram Research. And it still feels like a startup, even after 30 years. We're always doing new and different things. But we've been building the stack of technology that in recent times has gotten to a very exciting point, a point where I think a lot of people, a lot of other startups, can start to do things that are really qualitatively different than has been possible before in the software world. So the thing that I'm mostly going to talk about here is what we call Wolfram language, which is kind of a merger of the technology that we built in Mathematica, which has been used for the last quarter century or more to make all sorts of inventions and discoveries and so on, and the technology we built in WolframAlpha, which is used in things like the Siri intelligence assistant and other things, and is also used by lots of people as sort of an everyday question answering system on the web. It's a merger of those two technologies together with a lot of new ideas, particularly about the way that one deploys advanced software on the cloud, mobile, supercomputers, embedded systems, and so on. So, this is what I'll talk about. Something that's been exciting for me to see just in the course of this year, sort of rapid growth in the use of Wolfram language, winning hackathons, startups being based on it, lots of different things happening. Why don't I actually show you a little bit about it? And I'm always, this is what happens if you run a software company for 30 years, you actually only can do live demos. And let's see. One thing I should say, I'm going to show you kind of at first the desktop version of Wolfram language. Anything that I'll show you here, you can also do in the cloud. And actually, as of about a month ago, we now have open cloud, so you can just go to our website, click on something, and be there live doing things. Okay, let's see. Okay, 2+2 works. That's always a good sign. Okay, let's see if something else works. Okay, good. That's also a good sign. So the way that we start off interacting with Wolfram language is you give it some input, it figures out what you mean and generates output. There are other ways that you interact with it when you're using APIs, when you're embedding it and so on, but this is kind of the easy way to see what's going on. So this is so what can we do with Wolfram language? So we can do all kinds of things. The sort of idea of the language is to have it build in as much as possible, build in as much knowledge as possible about how to compute things, knowledge about the world, data, and so on. But most languages are set up to be to have a language that is small, but the language itself has very little content, where perhaps there are libraries that people have added somewhat incoherently past over the years, but the language itself is small. What I've tried to do in Wolfram language is spend the last 30 years building up this very large, coherent system where all the different pieces fit together, and in particular where we've tried to automate as much as possible. So sort of the idea is you explain to the language what you want to have done, and it will as automatically as possible try and get that done. So for example, we could type in, you know, we could say make a random graph, it's a pretty good approximation to my Facebook friend graph. We could say something like do a computation on this graph, work out the communities in this graph, okay, we get a result like that. So the idea is we're able to compute with any kind of data, any kind of structure in the language. So let's say we pick up another kind of thing, let's say we make, okay, that's a good one, let's try again. Okay, there we go, that's an image. Okay, so now we can go ahead and just do computations on this image. Let's say we want to detect edges in the image, that's the result. Or we could say something like, let's dynamically edge detect the current image. So I'm writing a piece of code here in Wolfram language, and we get the results, and we can do all sorts of things there. So we can do all kinds of computations with all sorts of kinds of data. Let's say we just want to make a picture of something. I don't know, we can make something like this. We could take some data, or just plot something like this. Okay, great. Now we can say, okay, let me make a user interface here. We kind of automate the process of making this user interface for us. So we put in a parameter there. We can make this, a parameter like that. We can vary that parameter, do things with it. So yeah, I'm just putting in this kind of symbolic specification of manipulate this with respect to this parameter. The user interface automatically gets created that allows me to do that manipulation. So, okay, The next big thing about open language is that it deals with things about the real world. So, for example, we can say something like, I don't know, we can say New Orleans, hopefully from the next. So one of the things that's really important about open language that really distinguishes it from pretty much every other language that's in common use out there is that it's a symbolic language. So if you just type in X, it says, okay, that means X. It doesn't have to have a value or anything like that. And everything it deals with is just a symbolic object. So this is another kind of symbolic object that happens to represent, you know, a 3D graphic sphere. New Orleans is another kind of symbolic object that just happens to represent the city. And so we can ask it, for example, we can ask it like, you know, what's the population of New Orleans? So we can say something like, say, where is it? Or that looks like a weird VPN location. Okay, let's say we want to know something like, let's do something like this. Let's use some other real world data. Let's make a map. We'll make a disk around the center of New Orleans. Let's say 10 miles radius. Let's go ahead and do that. And now we can do this, and assuming that we can pull in data fast enough. Again, this is usually rather much more instantaneous than this. Oh my gosh. Well, it obviously couldn't tell. It's interesting. It's what it does when it can't get some of the data. That's interesting. It's not too embarrassing. Okay, now I've got a little bit more. Anyway, if it had worked, it would have drawn us a nice map of New Orleans. Again, this is all stuff that's sort of integrated into the language. So we could say, for example, I don't know, we could get something like a list of words in English. Again, this is a lovely world of sort of close integration of the cloud and other things. But let's say I want to do something like, I'll write this code here. I'll take the first letter of each of those words, and now, for example, I can make a word cloud that shows me the relative frequencies of different letters in first letters in words in English. So it's kind of gives you some sense of how you can do, that's a very microscopic piece of kind of data science that we could do here. Let's say, for example, we could just say, let's get counts of all those letters. Okay, let's make a bar chart of those things with labels on the bar chart. Let's see here. And that will then again just show us the relative frequencies of the letters. So simple stuff, but this is very, very straightforward to do here. And we can deal with all sorts of different kinds of data about things. Like, let's say we want to have data about, let's say we have the painter Van Gogh. We could ask, you know, what are some notable artworks of Van Gogh? We could then get some list of things here, and then we could, for example, say let's take a bunch of those notable artworks. Let's say let's take the first 10 of those notable artworks, and then let's figure out images from those artworks. Okay, there they are. And now, for example, we could say let's make a chromaticity plot that shows. Works. Yeah, there we go. That shows the distribution of colors that were used in that in those particular paintings of Van Gogh. So the idea is to build in as much knowledge about the world and as much knowledge about algorithms as possible. So another kind of area that where there's a lot of things that we've done is in machine learning, and we've kind of try to automate as much of machine learning as possible. So for instance, I could go here, let me go to the web and search for a beaver, how about that? Let's get a picture of I don't know why I put the beaver. Let's try taking all those guys. Let's try that guy there. Let's just say this. So now let's image identify this thing here. And it says a porcupine. Okay, now with that embarrassment, I couldn't tell if that's a porcupine. I'm not. It knows about maybe 10,000 different kinds of things. Let's see. Let's try that guy there. Okay, that looks more promising. But in any case, you know, we could, if we wanted to, we could get, we could just do a search on the web for something like a beaver, and we'll get out some sort of computable version of that. Oh, great. Let's not wait for this. Oh, okay. Just to give an example of how we're kind of dealing with data sets, we can deal with data sets of all kinds of sizes and shapes and so on. This should bring us in some, if it wakes up, come on, web. Well, okay. Should bring us in a nice data set that we can then play with. Okay, there we go. So let's say, for example, we just take the first pictures, the first, let's take that, and let's take all the first things there, and let's just get a list of them. Okay, there are a bunch of beaver pictures. Now we could, for example, say, and I'm just showing you how you can write the code here, you can say make a column, oh no, no, let's just label each picture. This is just one language code. Label each picture with the image identification of that picture. And let's try doing that. So now we'll run that. Okay, so there it will say different kinds of things about what the. Okay, that one goes to the person, that one goes to the bottom. That's good for the person. Okay, so this just gives a sense of what's going on. And you can train your own machine learning classifiers and so on. In fact, we will soon have a very, very beyond state-of-the-art kind of framework for doing that. Right now, we have a very automated way to let you sort of train on different kinds of data sets. Okay, so this is some sense of what open language can do, sort of running inside your computer. There are lots of different areas that it covers. Lots of different kinds of things we can do here. The thing that perhaps I should show you is kind of how do you take all these things that you can compute, whether it's about financial data or whether you've got data on all kinds of things. You know, if you say something like a left femur, we know that's an anatomical structure. Let's say we want the mesh region for a left femur. Okay, so there's a sort of ad version of a femur that we can do computations on and so on. So lots of different kinds of thousands of different domains of knowledge that we've been sort of collecting and curating data on for the last decade or more. But the next question is, okay, so this is stuff that you can do kind of on desktop. How do you deploy this and actually use it in the cloud, for example? So there's a very simple way to do that. We have this function called cloud deploy, and we make a very simple app. And I'm going to use, so one of the features here is that there's a lot of natural language understanding going on. It's the same thing that we would use in the case of WolframAlpha to understand, all sorts of random queries from the coming from Siri and so on. Here I just asked it to generate a piece of code and it should be instantaneous. Why isn't it? Who knows? Okay, there we go. So that just created a piece of code from natural language, and I can go and say, add a green background to this, and that again should sort of instantly be able to create code from natural language. Natural language is particularly useful when you're dealing with things that come from sort of people in the outside world interacting with applications and so on. I don't know why this is so slow, but in any case, okay. So let's say here we want to create a simple app. So let's have an app which takes a, we're going to create, make it a form, an app that's based on a form, and let's say we're going to have that form be, take a the name of an animal, and it's going to show us an image of that animal, that's magnified a bit, okay, let's say we're going to show it on the web as a PNG, okay, let's actually make the permissions for this public, so I'm going to create a public, a little web app here. So okay, so we run this. Now we get a URL here. We go to that URL, and now we've got this little application where we can type it. Let's type an author there, for example. And now we'll go and we get a picture that was based on this code that we just wrote. We can change the code if we want to. We can say, rotate the thing through a certain angle. And we can then say, put another field here that says, put the angle. You can make this a slider if we want to. Let's just make this a regular field that just says, give us, put in a number there. Now we'll make a new app, so to speak, that has an animal and an angle. This app will still deploy it on mobile, so you just bring that up on your phone. If it had an image that's taking its input, those fields would turn into take an image type things. But we can also take this, instead of making it the form, we can make it the API. So now we've got, this will now generate a web API. Web API will just give an error if we don't give it parameters, so we have to give it to, animal equals tiger, ampersand angle equals three or something, Now we'll then run this API and generate a picture of the title. So now you can take that API and you can embed it in any piece of code that you have. So if you say, let's say, give me the embed code for that API for Java, for example, and give us the Java code that we need in order to embed the API in an external program. So you can do that running the, so you simply take, you can write this kind of a piece of code, use that as something to create an API that runs against our cloud, and then put that API into your external program to do whatever you want with it. You can also take the interface that we have here and deploy that. So if I say, cloud deploy, let's say, and manipulate of, I don't know, let's take a simple box here, we could say, let's say something like this. Okay, so now this is going to take a plot that we have. Please let me make the permission to publish, so I don't have to worry about logging in. This is now going to deploy an interactive with the user interface here. Oh, come on. So this will now be an interactive thing that can run, you can embed in any website, you can run that. It's running against our cloud, and it's pretty silly actually when the web is behaving properly. You can also, let me just show you another thing, you can actually take the whole user interface that I've been showing you, and you can go here and go to our development platform, and you can just go and say, create your notebook, I'm not even logging in here. You can start doing computations and creating code right here in browser. And you can go and deploy, you can actually, for free and without logging in, things, you can do some deployments that don't last very long, which you can then get started with that. Okay, so I'm going to run out of time in a moment, so I just want to finish off mentioning a few other things. So kind of the idea here is, this is the way, our idea is to set things up so that we built as much knowledge about computation, about the world as possible into the language. We've automated as much as possible about how to compute things and how to deploy things. And I might mention that one of the things that we've also done Internet of Things kinds of things is a thing called Wolf Data Drop, which is a thing that allows you to take, let's see, what's a good example here, how about that? That's, so this is something where I have, this is something from my house here, let's just see what happens. This is the temperature of a hot water tank of my house, and it's got some sensor on it, and that's pushing data into, that's pushing data into our cloud, and now I can do whatever analytics I want on this data, and have all sorts of fancy analytics. And I can then take this and put it into an app, or set it up as an API, which I can then call for another program and so on. So I see this as being from one of the things that. The idea is make as high as possible a level of automation in the programming language so that the humans can get to figure out what they want to do and get the computer to deal with it as automatically as possible. One of the interesting kind of side applications of this is the education. One of the things that's now happened is with this language, we've kind of got convergence between the language and system that kind of the fanciest R&D folk in the world use with the kind of thing that you can realistically teach to kids. And so I've been sort of interested in how do you take this language and how do you make it sort of a really good educational experience to teach not just sort of the engineering of programming, but kind of the idea of computational thinking. So, for example, one of the things I've been having a thing called Programming Lab, which is intended for kids, it's the exact same technology and the exact same system that's intended for software developers, but it's intended for people who are just starting to learn programming. It's kind of an interesting exercise. I wrote this book, which you can find free on the web a few months ago. Sort of an interesting exercise, something like mathematics that's been 1,000 years of history, to figure out kind of what's the sequence in which you teach the concepts. We don't have that for computational thinking, but I think we now have the raw material to teach computational thinking very broadly to people. And I think not only can we teach computational thinking to lots of people, we can also now expect to use computational thinking in a much deeper way to do much more algorithmic kinds of things in the world of startups and so on. And I hope some of you will be interested in this. We've seen just this year a really dramatic kind of absorption of the things that we're doing in the startup world. I think we even have a booth here, and I'm going to be wandering around there. I don't think there's time for questions here, but I'll be happy if people come by our booth. I'll be happy to try and pleasantly answer questions. And there are probably some people there who can show you about things that we've been doing as well as me. So, thank you very much.